A few more questions. 5150. For those who have been living on the moon, was Eddie Van Halen's studio in his backyard, his home studio. Ted has said that it was very uncomfortable in there. It was smaller. And the room didn't sound good. Numerous other things. Is that correct?
Well, I don't know if he ever said the room didn't sound good. I think he said it sounded different than what he liked. I think that he was always very clear with me that it was a matter of taste. He said that, you know, what Eddie and Alex and Don were getting out of 5150 was, you know, was something that was sonically unique. But he said, you know, you couldn't, there was no ability to generate a room sound up there. And that was one thing that really was difficult for Ted. He said, that's why, like Sunset, you could get a good room sound. He also talked about, in terms of the comfort level, when 5150, again, this is Ted's take on it, when 5150 was being built initially, it was supposed to be a demo studio. And what I mean by that was that it was supposed to be a place where, instead of having to use a little four-track tape on a coffee table in Eddie's bedroom or something, or his, you know, he'd actually have a room where they could actually have a little ability to record, like a little tiny drum set or whatever, and just to be able to record. It said that after Don, who with Howard Weiss built the studio up there, and it sounded so incredible, that that's when those guys approached Ted and said, we should try to do a record up here. And at the time, Ted said, it was really unfinished. So you look around this room, it's a built out finished studio. There were exposed 2x4s, there were things that were like wires on the floor. He said that the patch bays, the only one who could actually decipher the patch bays was Don, that Don had it all memorized. And so he said, like, I don't know about this. But he said, you know, those guys were really excited about what they were getting. And he said, it's a matter of taste. He's like, but it wasn't what I liked sonically. He would say it sounded bad. It just was different. He said, I liked the sound of Sunset. And the other thing he said that was, I think, relevant here, a couple of things, is number one, you know, we look at the control room, right? I'd never been in here before, but it's much bigger than I actually expected. But he would talk about how, because 5150 was a relatively small space, he said it was very confined and just very claustrophobic. So he said that for him, that was a tough thing. He also said that when he works at Sunset or he worked at Amigo, correct me if I'm wrong, Don was always on his
left.
On his left.
Yeah. And he's on the right, on the producer's table on the end, on the right. And Don's working the board from the middle to the left.
And at 5150, it was flipped. Yeah. But, you know, Ted was always, I think it kind of goes to the nature of the friendship between Ted and Don. I mean, Ted was always very clear that he's like, what Don did was incredible. He's like, basically, he took like, you know, like a room and turned it into this like world-class, incredibly 1980s sounding room that was sort of, took things to a whole different level in terms of sonics. So he was always very careful to say that even though it wasn't what I would have preferred, you know, it just kind of, to have Don have built that thing by hand. He's like, you know, Ted said to me, you know, Don was like a pilot who could build the 747 by parts. You'd like, you know, leave the guy alone in a warehouse, you know, for 2 months and you come back and the 747 would be together. He said, and then he could fly the plane. That's what he said. So he said, you know, for him, there was that. He also, I think, wanted to try to exercise some caution with those guys to be like, look, I'd been to home studios before. He had been, for example, to Brian Wilson's house and sort of seen what can happen when there's no meter running, so to speak, and there's not a lot of...
no structure.
No, just an ability to sort of say, it's got to be done by this time. And Ted was really always the guy who was able to deliver these records on time. He was an executive of the company and was responsible for these budgets. And so he also, you know, I think regardless of what, whatever anyone would say about, oh, well, he's with the record company, what does he care what the band gets charged? I mean, Ted always had been an artist himself and wanted to make sure that, you know, you weren't getting billed for ridiculous stuff, because this stuff all sort of goes on the band's debt. So he had misgivings about working at 5150, but he said, I wanted to give it a try because I respected what, those guys were so excited about it, and I knew that, like, Don particularly had poured his heart and soul into building this thing. You know, and that, he said, that was why. But yes, he wanted to do the album at Sunset. He was kind of like, he couldn't quite understand why, but they would want to do that, but he went ahead with it. The other thing that Ted has said to me numerous times, he said, you know, as much as I think that we ran into a lot of problems up there. I think if you read the book, you can kind of see what those problems were. He said, the other thing I recognize is that one of the reasons why Jump came out so great was that there was no meter running, and that those guys had the time, right? They started really working on the album in, I don't know, something like April or May of 1983, and they worked on Jump for a long time. He said, but that would be like, you know, part of the reason that happened was that Don was able to be behind that little board up there going, it's great, keep going. And I wasn't, you know, Ted wasn't up there. This was just Don and Ed just sort of like playing the stuff. And he said, I'm not sure. And I think, you know, it's to credit to Ted is saying that. He's like, I'm not sure if we worked a sunset that Jump would have come out as incredible, because we might have finished it. I might have said, okay, this is it, we're done with the song, before it fully evolved into the sort of classic that it was, with all the different parts and the, you know, the little things that Ed and Don did with it, and Alex. So, you know, I think that's the basic crux of it, was that Ted had misgivings about not working at Sunset with the lack of structure, had some misgivings about the Sonics, only because he said, like he said, it's like chocolate versus vanilla. I just preferred chocolate, and those guys like this vanilla. Breaking with what had been kind of a consistent pattern. The only reason why with Diver Down they worked at Amigo for part of it, I think, was because it had to be done on such short notice they couldn't get in here. They did some of the stuff here.
Did some of it.
Right, they couldn't do it all here only because they couldn't get in, right? That's what I think that Don and Ted both told me, that they were just, it had to be done in such a rush that they couldn't book the room.
Do you personally think, personally, and I know you've written the book on Ted, and I think you know what I'm going to ask, that he built 5150 to just kind of ease his, of course he's not going to say, Eddie is going to say, I'm trying to escape Ted, I want to be on my own, because he wanted, at the same time, he wanted to start producing. And that brings us to Alan Holdsworth, which, you know, he brought that to Ted. Do you think he was trying to go out on his own and he could produce himself? He had Don Landy up there with him. You know, they started running out the back door with the tapes. I mean,
yeah, I think, you know, I don't think, I'll tell you, only
you think
you
he just wanted to practice house it as, you know, just
no, I
briefly.
Mean, I think what I learned from talking to Ted was that Ted recognized that Ed was growing as an artist, and he's like, this is part of was Ed's interest in trying to do more stuff as a musician, whether it be the keyboards or working on the production of records. I think the example that Ted always pointed to in talking about this was that there was a band meeting up at 5150 right after they had sort of opened the facility, and so the four guys were up there, and Ted came up, and they were, I think they were probably meeting to figure out when they were going to start work or whatever. They were up there talking, and Dave said, according to Ted, hey Ted, would you excuse us for a minute? And he said sure, and they all walked into 5150 and closed the door. And Ted said, I didn't think anything of it. I just was, whatever I was doing, I was standing outside and or sitting on the bench and just, you know, waiting. And he said that eventually Ed came out and he was like upset. He said, what's wrong? He's like, I can't believe he'd said that to you. Ed said, what are you talking about? He's like, oh, he should have invited you, and I can't believe he said that to you. Like, you know, basically the implication was that Eddie felt angry that Dave had, you know, I don't know that Roth meant anything by it, but basically that he was trying to shut Eddie, felt that Eddie was afraid that Ted was thinking, oh, they're already trying to shut me out of this place. But, you know, he said that wasn't like what it was like at all. I just think, you know, there was a difference of opinion, especially about the keyboard material, right? That started to be, you know, I think for...
It's too poppy. It should be more raunchy.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's right. And I think that one of the things that ended up happening was that there probably was some miscommunication about things that got really built into resentments, I think. I think, you know, Ted tried to be careful when he did the book with me to say that I thought Jump was a great song. I just didn't think it fit. I was afraid it wasn't going to fit with Van Halen. I just thought it was going to be something that people weren't going to accept for Van Halen. He's like, I didn't think, you know, it wasn't as I thought that, wow, this isn't cool. He's actually thought when it was finished, he's like, this is amazing. But he's like, oh my gosh, if people hear this, and they think, what happened to Van Halen, right? That's what he was thinking as a producer, you know. And so I think that was part and parcel, you know. And again, a lot of other issues that I think if you read the book, you can kind of pick up on that probably didn't help things. But you know, at the end of the day, I mean, you know, Ted is, I think, an optimistic outlook on it. I mean, the one thing he always likes to joke about is that he said at some point that he and Eddie were having a disagreement about Jump, or you know, he says, like, it sounds like something, it's going to be, you know, sounds like an organ in a basketball stadium or something, or a baseball. Sounds like the organ in a baseball game, you know, and whatever Eddie said. And they were sort of going back and forth about this, debating it. And Ted said, he goes, well, I was right. He goes, now when you go to a baseball game, you pretty much can't ever go to a sporting event and not hear the song Jump played over the PA system. You know, he's like, so I was right. You know, of course, you know, but that's the type of stuff, like, you know, that I think probably led to some you know, a lot of fraying. You know, and again, a lot of the other stuff, too, probably was, let's not forget, part and parcel of the split that was happening with Roth as well. I mean, there wasn't just, you know, Ted fracturing. There was a ton of a double split going on there. But, you know, the album did get finished. It did sell 10 million copies. So it's like, you know, no one wants to go to the hot dog factory, right, and see how the hot dogs are made. They just taste delicious. So let's just enjoy the delicious album when it's finished and not think about the hot dogs.